All right, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. Welcome to our webinar, Development and Maintenance of your Embedded Linux Vision System Simplified, a collaboration between NXP, Toradex, and Ozone. I'm your moderator, Bosco Jung with NXP Semiconductors. Thank you for joining us today. Toradex is one of our goal partners in our NXP partner program. Toradex is a global company headquartered in Switzerland. It is focused on offering to make highly reliable embedded computing easy for you. Toradex offers ARM-based system and module SoMs and customized SBCs powered by NXP's SoCs such as i.MX 6, 7, and 8 family. These pin-compatible SoMs offer scalability, long-term product availability, and industrial-grade software such as its latest offering, Torizon, an open source and easy to use industrial platform. And Ozone Technologies, again, our goal partner, is a leading provider of development tools, engineering design services, and enabling IP use for the design and development of intelligent devices at the edge. Utilizing their tools, reference designs, and services, Ozone assists their customers to quickly develop and securely deploy ML solutions and novel CNNs on application processors and MCUs. Ozone, Toradex, and NXP have built a strong relationship over the years to provide our customers the ecosystem that you can leverage. Today, we have Daniel Lang from Toradex and Marcus Libby from Ozone to talk to you about their recently introduced SoM-based i.MX applications processor. We'll have the time dedicated for the Q&A at the end of the webinar, so please take a moment now to find the question box on your GoToWebinar user interface. Please submit your questions in the question box at any time during the session, and our speakers will answer as many questions as time permits at the end. Also, if you'd like to follow along as we present our material, you can download today's presentation in the handout section of the GoToWebinar user interface. Also, this presentation will be recorded and be available to you for a later time from nxp.com and from Toradex. So without further ado, I will ask Daniel to begin his presentation.
Thanks so much, Bosco. Welcome from my side. So let's get started. So Bosco already gave you an overview about Toradex, so I will not say much more. Maybe the only thing here you can see additionally is that we have a global presence. So in all these places, we have local support, we have local warehouse, so we can serve our customer locally in this key market. So today we will talk about the development and maintenance for embedded vision systems. And here you can see an overview of systems already using today Toradex. So many of these systems, they using traditional computer vision, machine vision, but today we will mostly focus on deep learning, and some of them already deploy today deep learning solutions. I will not go over it, that just gives you a feeling about the variation of applications we already use and that our products are really a good choice for these kind of applications. So already the first question for you, Bosco talked, I talked a little bit about who we are, what we are doing. Now we would like to know a little bit, who are you? So we'll talk about hardware and software, but it would be nice to know a little bit, where you focus on. So are you a hardware developer? Or are you a software developer? Or are you a hard and software developer? Or maybe you're not a developer, maybe you're a product manager, maybe you're an executive. So please let us know here so I can adjust a little bit the presentation and know, who you are. Please make your choice. I will give it, 5 seconds more and we will have a look at the result. I hope you can see it. You can really click on it. Please get active. Good. So we see here most of the people are actually do hardware and software. So that would be that's very good because we will cover both with a little bit. If it's separate, there is a little bit more a software developer than hardware development, and a lot of developers here. So I think that's good for the audience, even if it's not too deep technically. But I think it gives you a good understanding of the processes involved. Okay, moving on. So here, just an example of a vision project we cover here. So you get a little bit of feeling what you could do. So here we have an example of a seedling monitoring, a plant monitoring system, which then provides water and fertilizer depending on the status of the plant. So here we have a tractor pulling a trailer with the water and fertilizer, and we have a sprayer at the end, and we have a camera which looks at the plant and then makes the decision based on that. We, in this system, in this agriculture tractors, CAN bus, it's a communication bus which normally runs there, and we would like to connect a camera to it so we can get a reading of the speed, we know how fast we go, and we can also use it to control the fertilizer spray. We do have connectivity to the cloud where we can receive updates, but we can also share results, we can share statistics. However, this connection will not be reliable. So if you're in the field, even you have 5G, you cannot expect to have always connection. If you choose Wi-Fi, you may only have connection if the tractor in the system is parked at the farm. So all the machine learning and the computer vision needs to be locally. We cannot rely on the cloud for this application. And these kind of systems are, you know, very typical. And when we go through the slides, you can maybe reference that, or you can keep application like that in mind. Now let's, I think I skipped one here. Now talk about the different phases you go when you develop. So the first one is going to be the proof of concept. Then you will have a development phase, and then at the end you will have a production and maintenance phase. And in today's world, the production and maintenance is actually still kind of part of the development, because you want to iterative improve on your solution, provide updates, fix patches, maybe even provide updates which are paid. So maybe you ship your hardware, the hardware is fixed, but you can charge your customer to get additional features. So you can continue monetize your solution you already deployed maybe years ago. So, but here we start with the proof of concept. So in the proof of concept phase, you really want to focus on the value, on the key problems. You cannot solve everything at that phase. You just want to focus on a key. So very focused. You want to be fast, because maybe the idea you had, it turns out it's not possible. So you need to try out another one. So you want to move fast. This phase typically takes from a couple of days to a couple of weeks, depending on the project. So now we will talk you how we can help you in this phase of the proof of concept. So for this presentation, we start at the hardware, really at the bottom, and then move up the stack up to the application, software application. However, in reality, many times you actually would start with your application and then select your hardware depending on your needs from that. But for that, as I said, we start with the hardware. So we have this tractor application, we need vision. So we know about the i.MX 8 and plus, it has a neural network accelerator. So it sounds like that would be a good choice. So we would choose a Verdin, a system on module with the i.MX 8 and plus. And why is that a good choice for proof of concept? So the Verdin family is pin compatible. So in this phase, you many times do not exactly know how much performance do you need? Do I really need a neural network accelerator? How much RAM do I need? And if you use a Toradex system on module, you can be flexible. You can change, upgrade, downgrade, even improve proof of concept already run some experiments. We also have extensive documentation, including a step-by-step guide, very detailed. So you don't need to learn everything in detail, how it works. You can just follow the step-by-step guide, so you can focus on your application or your own key problems you want to investigate. There's also community and local support, so if you run into any issues, you have get a lot of help. Then on the software side, from Toradex, you get the operating system out of the box. The one recommended proof of concept is our Torizon. I will talk about that later a little bit, what that exactly is. But we also have a reference image for the Yocto project. So if you're familiar with Yocto project, or you want to do a deep customization already in the proof of concept phase, we do have some reference images you can use and start there. So now, I think we get to our second poll about how familiar you are about the i.MX 8 M Plus application processor from NXP. I hinted a little bit, that's the one we choose, but it would be interesting to know how much you know about it. Maybe you don't know much about it, or you know about the key features. Maybe you attended a webinar already where they featured that, or you read up a little bit on the website. Or you're very familiar, so you really study the data sheet, you know that's a good choice, or you know for a reason it's not a good choice, but you know it in really detail, or you maybe even work already with it. Please make your choice. We give you a few seconds, and then we will look at the results all together. Good. I think we can look at the results. Okay, so we don't have a lot of people which are very familiar, and we have about the equal thing for people who are not familiar and people who already know a little bit the key features. Okay, so let's. So I have here a slide about the Verdin i.MX 8 M Plus. Now I will hint on some of the really key features of the i.MX 8 M Plus, which is of course on the heart of this system on module. So the i.MX 8 M Plus, it comes with four Cortex A53. Running pretty fast. You also have a Cortex M4 microcontroller on it, running very fast for a microcontroller, and that microcontroller can be used, for example, for low latency tasks. So, for example, in a vision system, we for example, control light, you know, triggers and things like that with that, but it can also be used for other real-time applications. Then the RAM, that's more a feature of our module. We can also get you an 8 gigabyte if that's, you know, if you need that. Our default configuration is up to 8 gigabyte RAM. There is an option to have ECC protected. That means error corrected and memory, making more reliable system. And we have 16 gigabyte of flash. Then here, just some highlights important for our vision application at the beginning. So we have two MIPI CSI camera interfaces. We have the neural network processor, really a standout feature of the i.MX 8 M Plus. And why is that important? So neural network processors are much more optimized than, for example, a GPU, so they can get the same performance, but with a much lower thermal and power footprint. We have an image processor directly on the system, so we can use a much wider selection of sensors, like Sony sensors, which don't have the ISP integrated. And we can do things like HDR, which probably would be important for our application where light outside is, you know, challenging. Maybe you have the sun in there, so you want to have a high dynamic. We have 3D GPU. If you want to connect the camera otherwise, there would be 2 gigabyte Ethernet or a USB 3.1 connection. Gigabyte one also has a TSN, that means time-sensitive networking. If you need to do real-time things over the Ethernet, that's one way to do it. The system has a range of display interfaces, the CAN we will need in our demo. It has Wi-Fi, you know, dual band, AC, Wi-Fi here. Also has hardware thing, wide temperature range, important for application outside where you can have the sun shining on it or being very cold. And you have long-term availability. So that's ideal. You can ship the same hardware for long, all the development investment you can recoup over many years, but you can still continue to deploy software updates there for many, many years. Now you also need a carrier board. So for proof of concept, we normally recommend one of our development boards. So that's either the full development board, it's pretty big, but you have this pin muxing area, so you can try out all the muxing. Or you have the Dahlia, a much smaller development board, only focusing on the key interfaces, but very convenient. You can use USB-C to power and debug at the system. So very kind of nice if you have it on your desk. But now talk about a new version. So that's basically a brand new. We just brought up the website, and I will show you there on the website. It's a Maven modular full stack AI vision system, and it's something we did in collaboration with Ozone and Vision Component. So let me show you here on the website. So this is this new website, as mentioned, a collaboration. Ozone did the base hardware and also the AI vision application, Vision Components is the sensor, the camera module we use here. So for what kind of application is it used for? It's designed for agriculture. Oh, good, perfect for the use case. We have also said that like Ken, you know, the Sony seller, we also have an option for a modem. So it's an M.2 slot, so you can add a modem. But also other use case would be robotics, industrial automation, healthcare, where this would be a very good fit. It's modular, we'll talk about that a little bit later. Full stack meaning it's the hardware, but up to the application software, OS, everything included. It's designed for fast prototypes, but it's also designed that you have a path to go into volume production. And it comes with an over-the-air update feature, which we'll look a little bit closer in the production maintenance phase of that webinar. Here, as I said, modular, we'll talk about that a little bit later. One thing I should mention when it's available, so this is currently still in development, and we expect a general availability about end of the quarter in June. If you need to know more or like to get updates, please, you know, sign up for updates. There is also at the bottom a little bit more details about the roadmap. So now have a look at the software stack. So we talked about the hardware. We will talk about Torizon Core a little bit more. And then I will hand over to Marcus, who will cover about the machine learning part. So that's running here on the device, but it's also supplemented by development tools for your desktop, and it's even supplemented by this OTA and fleet management system you get with it. Good, so the next thing would be, you know, we talked about the hardware, now we would go to the operating system. So we recommend you to use Torizon, or this is the best out of the box experience. It's really designed to be fast time to market, means you can use it binary. So you do not need to build Linux yourself. It's open source, so it's everything open. It's built with the Yocto project, so you can fully customize it if you want. You can even bring it to other hardware if you like, but you do not have to. You can just use the binaries from us. As mentioned, it comes with an update, automotive-grade update solution. There's security built in, and there is an option for the RT patch from Linux, so you can have actually a real-time system. Also relevant for the proof of concept phase is the integration with additional software tool, software development tool. So it's really designed for a productive modern software development where you really DevOps iterative improve. We have plugins for Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code. So if you use any of these tooling with any of these languages, you can just install the plugin and it makes all the connection to the system. It's stuff is containerized, so this kind of hidden from you. And you can just begin to program, you can, you know, play deploy, and it will go deploy it to the device. You will be able to debug it like you would run the program on your desktop. You can set breakpoints. So very easy to get started, only takes a few minutes, and very easy to debug. Okay, with that, I think we go back to the presentation. So get back here. So we have here we talked about Torizon Core and we have the next poll. So in this poll I would like to ask you how familiar you are with computer vision, because now Marcus will talk a little bit about that. Are you totally new to it? Or maybe you developed proof of concept, some demos, you know, or you already have deployed commercial products and you're basically an expert and you know all the problems and the good and the bad, you know, if you develop about that. Please make your choice and we will come back here in a few seconds. Good, let's look at the result. Okay, so we have a lot of people new to it. So I think it's gonna be very interesting for Marcus and, you know, to show you the tool, how we collaborated with Ozone, which makes it ideal also for new people to get started and, you know, get ending up with an optimized solution for an embedded vision system. With that, I would hand over to Marcus.
Hey, thank you, Daniel. So actually, that was pretty interesting on that poll. And it's not a surprise because I think, you know, we kind of encounter the same situation. We find that a lot of people are very interested in computer vision or machine learning, especially at the edge, and have no idea where to start. And this is one of the areas where I think this Maven starter kit will be very useful for that purpose, especially when applied with the software from Ozone. So some of you may know me already. I previously, up until the end of last year, I was working at NXP, leading the machine learning side. And the 8M Plus device was actually one of my favorite devices over there, especially because it has the integrated neural network processor in there. And then I've joined up with Ozone recently, and together we are developing the machine learning and vision software that will run on top of the NXP platforms, and in particular for this case here on the Maven platform to enhance the out-of-the-box experience. So Ozone's been around for actually 20 years as a computer vision expert doing design services. And then in the last few years, we've been developing a tool called it's now called the NXP EIQ portal, which I'll show you a little bit about in the next few slides. Which this is an end-to-end development tool for model training and deployment. And then on top of that, Ozone is developing enhanced visual intelligence products that will fit and complement all of the EIQ portal tools and run on top of NXP devices. So next slide, please. Yeah, I should also want to point out, you know, Daniel, on your slide there on your website where you were showing the example applications for Maven, I think probably in reality it goes way beyond that, right? It's not limited to industrial and agriculture and healthcare. I think it's really because of the capabilities of this platform and what you can do with computer vision, it's basically up to the imagination of the developer. So I got a few slides here that will talk about the common challenges, and this is from our experience, what we see in dealing with customers, et cetera. But just to start this off here, I think one of the more common things is I need a rapid prototyping platform, something that I can just try out my software, get it running real quick. And I think the Maven is a perfect use case for that. And when you combine it with the software from Toradex as well as Ozone, you'll find that the out-of-the-box experience you won't necessarily get to your POC in an instant, but at least you'll be able to run some machine learning and computer vision applications really quickly. So as the poll highlighted, one of the key things here is that I think people know that they need ML and they don't know where to start. So let's go to the next slide. So this is a kind of a workflow for the NXP EIQ portal. And basically, you know, if you wanted to try to build a model and bring in your own data within, this is all GUI driven. So within 5 minutes, literally, if you had one of these Maven platforms hooked up to your development system, you could actually have a model running and profiling and doing some basic experimentation. So it takes you through the phase of the augmentation, model selection, training, et cetera, all the way through model validation. And of course, if you're not very familiar with computer vision or machine learning, maybe some of these concepts are just high level, you know, you might recognize them, but we certainly can go into more detail with you on a one-on-one basis as well. Next slide. So in the previous slide here, it showed the bring your own data approach. So you can bring in your own data and use some of the models that are part of the database, or you can bring in your own model. And you know, the framework that you use is up to you, whether you're familiar with PyTorch, Onyx, or TensorFlow. But the same process is applied here. So you can bring in your own model, and you could also do additional model training. So even though this shows a direct conversion and optimization to the and then deployment, you could also do steps where you bring in your own data, even if you brought in your own model. So it's a pretty flexible tool. It's all GUI driven. For the experts, it also has a command line capability. Okay. I think I'll go back to you and then I'll be back in a couple of minutes.
Thanks so much. So now we basically have our proof of concept. So if you follow all that and take advantages of all these tools and hardware, you should be able to build a proof of concept. And now the next phase would be the development phase. So obviously in the development, you're going to develop hard and software. Ideally, you do that in parallel to lower the development time. Also in this phase, you now need to really think about the feature set you want to deliver to the customer. You will need to begin to think about price, which is normally in proof of concept not so sensitive. But here in development, you have to have the whole project in mind, and you need to begin to optimize so that you can have a compelling solution for your customer. Also, this phase typically runs several months, depending on the project. So also here, we're going to start with the hardware. But as I said, typically that's in parallel. So on the hardware side, the most common way how people use or develop hardware is actually they use some of our standard carrier board, like the development board or Dahlia I showed you, and they're fully open source. So they come with complete Altium design file, they come with layout guide and design guide. There is tooling helping you with the pinout. And people typically take that as a base and then customize it for their own use. But not all of our customers have the time, resources, knowledge to do that. If you don't want to do that, you can work with our partners. So we have a proven partner network. That means these customers, they were successful with our modules to bring a carrier board to the market. Our customer was happy. We were happy to work with them. They were happy. So it's really, you don't need to do a big evaluation. We already did that and kind of vetted the partner for you. There you have basically two options. Either you use an off-the-shelf, so many of the partners have off-the-shelf boards where you can just plug in our module and it works, or they do customization for you. You can go with your requirements to them and they will customize it for you, either just do the design or they do the full turnkey with manufacturing and everything. And for you, it means low risk because they're proven, and also their pricing norm is very competitive because they don't start that from scratch. They know already the platform. They know the software, they know how to work with Toradex, and most of the time they use already a design they have and they just modify it for them. And then here we also have a kind of a newer version with Upverter. So that was called Gumstick. It was called Geppetto until recently, and it got acquired by Altium. So this is all part of the Altium ecosystem. And it's basically a drag and drop development tool online. And I will show you, how that looks. So give me a second here. I bring up the web browser again. And let's go here. So that's on our developer site. So we have an Upverter online tool. And here you can design your own carrier board. So let's say you can choose the size. Then let's drag in a Verdin module, and just drop it. And it tells me now, oh, it needs power. And now I can click on, I need power, and it gives me some options here. So let's say I take here a pretty powerful regulator, drop that on and say, hey, I need a power in. So I select here a barrel connector and drop it here. And you can see it's getting green. So stuff is connected. And we say, oh, we're doing vision today, right? So probably need a camera interface. So I can go and let's say take here a camera connector and drop it here. I also need 3.3 volts. I can get that from the regulator. I need a CSI. You can see the Verdin has two CSI interfaces. I pick one. I need an enable pin, let's say GPIO1 for that. And I need an I2C. And the Verdin here even has an I2C, especially for the camera. So I just took that up and you see, that's going to get green too. And so you go on, and in a few minutes, you build your carrier board. You can even have a 3D view here, a simple one, and look at your board. And you can also see the price. And so if you order it, immediately it's also shipped very fast. So it's a very short turnaround. And there is a setup fee for $2,000. But now, at the moment, we actually run a promotion. We waive you the setup fee. So you can actually try that out without the setup fee, and you just need to pay for your prototype. I think there's a minimum order of 6, so you have to order 6 of them, but no setup fee. Also, what I have to highlight here, because we focus really on i.MX 8 and Plus currently, this is support i.MX 8 and Mini, but because these models are pin compatible, It's very likely you can get started and then upgrade later to the i.MX 8M M Plus. You can also export here into other tools if you want to further customize it or for volume production. Maybe you want to, to do some further improvements. But I think a very cool tool. And yeah, take advantage of this. It's limited time. Basically, you save $2,000. Good. So let's get back to our presentation. So, and then of course, one big thing, a new solution is also you can use Maven, which you used already in your proof of concept. Now, if you go in development, you maybe need to customize it a little bit more for your use case. And because it's built modular, you can really do that. So you can select your camera. So it comes with a Sony sensor. Maybe you need higher resolution or more sensitivity or less. So you can change that optics, maybe a wider field of view or more narrow, a system on module. You can use any Verdin module, a rear connector. So that's also modular. So maybe you need a dual Ethernet. You maybe need waterproof connections for our use case. There is M.2. A connection on the bottom, so you can put a modem in there depending on your needs. And you also have an enclosure, which this is the default enclosure, but we can customize that, also make it waterproof. Maybe you need a metal one depending on your application. Okay, let's go to the next one. Now Torizon, why is Torizon useful for in the development, or what's the key differentiator in the development? Again, you do not need to actually work on the OS itself. You can just take it and deploy it into volume production. Visual Studio Code integration, we already talked about that. It's also very useful in development. Then the whole container ecosystem. So we use Docker containers on the system. So it means you can pull in other containerized software packages. For example, maybe you need a database. You can bring that in very easy, more or less one command. Or maybe even for our application, maybe we want to have a soft PLC to run all the controls. So we work with Codesys. Codesys provides a container for our system. You can pull that in very easily. And we also have something called Torizon Core Builder. This allows you to customize Torizon Core for your needs without the need to rebuild it. And customization can be additional peripheral, display settings, splash screen. Maybe you want to already include certain content or certain application when you're provisioning the device, so you can all do that, and then you can push that to update or push that through our factory programming solution. Also, it's fully customizable via the Yocto project, so if you want to tweak it or you have very special needs, you can do that in this phase of the development. And with that, I will get back to Markus for his second part, how Ozone can help you now in the development phase.
Thanks, Daniel. And I got to say, I'm a bit disappointed because we see the guitar in the background and we were hoping you would play a song during the webinar, but yeah, maybe the next one.
Next time.
So, as I was alluding to, when Daniel gave the examples that are posted on the website, definitely keep an open mind, because when it comes to visual intelligence and deploying this Maven platform, I mean, even this screen here just shows a small subset of the types of use cases that you can use for applying computer vision. So next slide. All right, so we see this guy still has his headache, and he's experienced some additional challenges to adding visual intelligence. So one of them here, another one is augmenting your data sets. And typically, actually, almost every developer in the AI space that we talk to says that the number one challenge is collecting the data. And this is something that's partially provided by some of the open and free data sets that you can download from various sources on the internet. But fundamentally, you're going to put your system into action and you're going to have a camera and you're going to start taking pictures and capturing your own data. You're never going to get to having full sample set. So augmenting data sets is a pretty key factor that's, I'll show you in a second, is part of the EIQ portal development tools. Another problem here is selecting the right model. So even if you're trying to narrow it down to an application like classification, there's many models that you can choose from. So that's something also to keep in mind. And then I'm repeating here what I said earlier, and I'll show you about how easy it is to rapidly deploy this machine learning software, especially the demos that will be provided as part of Maven. Just click button and you can have it running on this platform. So for augmenting the data sets, I don't show the tool specifically here, but you'll see in the bottom left-hand corner. And by the way, these are preliminary, so this GUI will be changing slightly before the release comes out in another few weeks. This tool is available for free, by the way, from NXP. And it'll allow you to go through all these steps that I showed earlier. But the augmentation tool will put you into a screen that shows all the options for how you want to augment your data, whether it's just rotational or changing the contrast or changing the color or whatever, to try to simulate different types of scenarios on a given piece of data. So in the next step here, you would, you'll also see at the bottom that, in the bottom left-hand corner right there, it shows you a button that will take you to the DPU value add tools. So you can see what you can apply on top of what's provided in this free tool here. But the next step would be in selecting the model. So if you'll click to the next slide, you'll see that you have three easy steps in the GUI. The first one is choosing what type of application, whether it's classification or detection. And this is, if you use the command line, you can get full access and understand exactly what's being selected for you. But if you're novice to this, this tool will make the selection based upon your application, based upon whether you're targeting a highest accuracy or highest performance or a balance. And then it'll also give you the option to choose which compute unit you're going to run this on. And in the case of the 8M Plus, you'll have the option of CPU, GPU, or NPU. Here, you're not really choosing the exact deployment, but it is going to select for you a model that may or may be more optimized for, for example, taking advantage of the performance on the NPU. So, and then once you've selected that, and you go to the next slide, you'll come to a screen that pops up automatic training. So here's where you've brought in your data, and you can have a variety of options to choose from: the batch size, the number of epochs to train, whether you want to enable quantization aware training, the QAT, and then it'll go through and you'll see a screen that kind of looks like this that shows the accuracy is improving over time. This doesn't look so great because I only set it for one epoch, right? So it only hit 30% accuracy or something. But if you get out to 10 or 20 or 30, depending on the model and the data, you'll start to see the accuracy go up above 80-90%. So here you also have the option of selecting additional DPU development tools. And if you go to the next slide, once you've done your training, then you'll get to a validation screen. This is a confusion matrix. And again, because I only chose one epoch and the accuracy is terrible, you'll see all this red and pink, but ideally you want all of the green to be along the diagonal, which means that you've hit pretty much the optimal, where your predicted more or less matches the actual in your training data set. So from here, you will click to the next. So you can click here where it says deploy, and this will actually take you to a screen where if you have the Maven connected up to a port on your development device, on your development platform, you can automatically just download the model to that platform and start doing actual performance profiling, and it'll show you where the hotspots are in your model, and you can start getting in and doing some tweaking or optimizations to your data set. Next. So I want to also share with you another list here of common challenges, and this is part three and my final part, but it's very high level, right? I mean, these at a high level are really the types of things, the issues that we see optimizing data sets. which basically means, okay, I have some data, but I'm still not getting the results that I want. The accuracy is terrible. I'm getting incorrect results. How do I go in and fine tune my data or decide what additional data I need to make my model run better? And of course, in the embedded space, everyone wants more optimized models. So whether you're optimizing for speed or whether you need to be a smaller footprint to fit on an MCU, this is a pretty key function here that goes way beyond pruning and quantization. And how do I take it to the next level of performance? And the rest of the list deals with a combination of running multiple models or integrating into an embedded vision pipeline or various things that are related to ML ops or lifecycle management. And you know, this, I'm sure you have some of the key challenges that you're also facing. And if you go to the next slide, let me just say that with Ozone, we can dissolve these challenges. So, you know, again, there are other challenges, and this is just a very high level perspective. But our tools, our DPU products that I've kind of highlighted down here on the bottom, will resolve a majority, if not all, of these types of challenges that you're experiencing. So, you know, again, inquire about these. You can send us an email, and we'll be glad to help you go down the path of your computer vision platform.
Okay. Thanks so much, Marcus. Yep. So now we basically the last part of the webinar, going about the production and maintenance. So I can call it production and maintenance, but it's actually still part of the development. So we really see that it's very common, and we really encourage you to use kind of the DevOps approach, where you constantly basically code, you build something, you test it, you release it, you deploy it. You actually operate it out in the field, you monitor it, and we can help you with that. And then you plan improvements on that, you know, implement them again, getting it out. And that's kind of a constant, you know, constant cycle to make your product better. Even you may don't update the hardware every, you know, 3 months, but on the software, you can really do that. We also, what you should do is a security. So you maybe have to provide security patches, especially if you're connected to the internet. You maybe want to do feature updates, and these are maybe even paid feature updates. So you can even charge in certain use cases more for the customer and say, hey, you get now an additional feature. You would like to do that, and it really enables your new business case. And this phase of the production and maintenance is going on for years. It can be, especially in our business, it can be quite for a while. And if you can generate additional revenue from devices you already deployed, that's very interesting. Of course, if you're a developer, you really like to be able to fix bugs, you know, if they somehow made it out in the wild, or, you know, the customer discovered it out. So to be able to update a system, I think nowadays it's very important. So that would bring us to the last questions for you. So it's about how many times do you think you will do field updates on your next product? Never. I mean, there are still use cases. It's not possible or too cumbersome. You test it once, you deploy it. Is that your use case? Maybe once a year, maybe only super critical stuff, or you know, maybe still manual. So you can't do it too much. Maybe you want to do it quarterly. So every quarter, maybe there's an update, or monthly, so quite frequently, like every month, which actually Toradex, we have that for our Torizon. We have quarterly production releases. We have monthly releases for development. So that's kind of where we are for the OS. Or you say even more often, you know, you're really, you know, deploy a lot. So let's take a few seconds here so you can think about it and make a choice, and then we will look at it. Good. Let's take a look at the results. Okay, so we see here a lot of people are here between the once a year or less, so they do updates, but very rarely. There is almost nobody doing no updates. And then there is quite some people do quarterly updates, which I think it's quite frequent already for our industry. And then of course the more frequent one, and there are still people, you know, doing that, but not, it's not that common. Good. So let's move to our OTA solution. I already mentioned it a little bit before. So Torizon is a complete platform with Torizon Core running on the embedded system. And then we have the Torizon platform with OTA, device monitoring, fleet management, and so on running in the cloud. And the update client is directly included in Torizon Core. We also have the cloud services as mentioned. So some here of the key features. So one thing is it's very reliable. So even you lose power in the worst possible moment, the system is not lost. So it will roll back, it will come back, boot up, connect again, and try to reboot reinstall the update. So it's very, very robust, which is one of the key things for us. You can update all software layers. Currently, we're really focusing on application level and operating system. So that's working. And we are also implementing currently bootloader updates. So this is something you normally don't want to update too much, but sometimes there's a security issue or something, you forces you to update to that, and we can do that with this solution. The security system we use, it's from the automotive, is a standard called Optane we use here, so it's very secure. One really key part, it's really integrated with everything. So typically, if you need a solution, you get the OTA solution, or you build it yourself, or it's a commercial solution, you have an operating system, you get from somewhere, and you have the hardware. In the case of Toradex, if you use Torizon, you get everything together. So everything is tested together, all the time. It's in our CI system. So the hardware works with the OS, it works with the OTA system, and we can detect that and provide you a very reliable solution. We have a device manager. I will show that a little bit later. And it's based on open technologies. So we do have a hosted service, but you can do it yourself. It's all open standards, open things. So you can really, there's no lock-in. You can replace parts or the complete system if you like to do that. With that, I will give you a small demo about our OTA solution. And I basically will show you the web interface. So this is our web interface running. So, and there is a free tier, so you basically can start for free. Get started, it's brand new, it's still early access. In the next weeks, you will see more communication about that. It will be a little bit more prominent on our website, but you can get started today. So it's there, we're just a little bit quiet about that because it's in a, it's a soft, we decided to do so a soft launch, but you can already do a lot. So here you see a dashboard. I'm here connected to our test fleet in our Brazilian office. You see here because we do tests. So we let update fails, we disconnect devices so you can all that. You also have fleet management. So for example, here we have a fleet M1 with all these devices. If I choose a device, for example, here, I can see what's installed. I can see the thing. I can see here, the software version installed. This is the operating system tag. This is the application tag. Of course, you can initiate an update. For example, for Horizon OS, you can choose if you want to have a monthly and nightly. If you want to choose the LTS, there's different variations. You can select one. RT means it's the real-time patch, maybe this one, and then you can say which version you would like to install, and then you can deploy it. I will not do that here because for time reasons, so it downloads, and then it's set up. The device connects to this service and pulls if there is a new update. If there is a new update, it pulls down. There's also control. When you want to do the update, you can block it and say, hey, the user should have control over it, or I want to make it, totally automatic. It's all up to you. But yeah, give it a try. It's free to try. So if you have our hardware, if you use Torizon, you can get just to start it. And then we also have a paid tier, which gives you more features, stuff, which is, important for people having bigger fleets or doing customization. But yeah, get in touch with you, and we like to show you that in even more detail. Good. That was basically the last part of this presentation. And now we arrived at the Q&A. And as Bosco said, there is a chat window. Please use that. to enter your questions, and we will try to pick it up. And I think I hand over to Bosco, which will moderate that part here.
Yeah, thank you, Daniel and Marcus, for the great information. We do have quite a few questions ready. For the interest of time, I will get right into it. If you have any questions, as Daniel mentioned, please submit it. Does Toradex provide CAD files for, and what format?
Yes, we provide CAD files. So we have the complete Altium design. We also have STEP files available. But the main thing is the Altium project file we provide for you.
Okay.
With BOM and everything included.
Thank you. And where can the customer find the reference Yocto image for i.MX 8 and Plus?
i.MX 8 and Plus, it comes pre-installed already, and you will find it on our developer page. Maybe I can even show that short. Give me a second. So first, there is a Toradex Easy Installer. So for our devices, if you put them up, there's a Toradex Easy Installer. It's a small GUI, comes up, and normally you can select it there and install it. For the i.MX 8 and Plus, it actually comes pre-installed with our multimedia reference image. And if you need another one or a newer one or want to go anything, you can go developer, and then we have a developer center, and you can find everything on here. You can go to software, select it, and so on.
Great. Good. And can the DSP Hi-Fi 4 can be used to run NN model?
The DSP, it's not really supported from our side. So we really looked at the DSPs in the other systems. Actually, on i.MX 8 and Plus, I'm not 100% sure, but for the other i.MX 8s we have, and you do actually not really support that. If you really need it, you can get in touch. We thought, and we really can detail, but we classified that as a kind of a niche application, which we would look at on a case by case. It's not something that just works out of the box.
Okay, great. The next question: what is the format that the model you bring is converted to when deployed in Maven?
I think I hand that over to Marcus. There's different variation and different, bring your own or do it, but Marcus maybe can.
Yeah, in the conversion process, the option is up to you too. And one of the screens that I didn't show was the actual deployment for an inference engine. So there's a screen that has a pull down, and you could use the proprietary customized DeepView RT engine, which has a lot of hooks to accelerate the performance on the 8M Plus NPU. But you could also choose ArmNN, TensorFlow Lite, Onyx runtime, and for the MCUs, you have the option to use Glow as well.
Okay, thank you. Next question, all power consumptions are TBD in the datasheet. When can they see these values in the datasheet?
Good question. We are still testing and optimizing. And the thing is, if we bring up the system at the really beginning, we're really focusing on functionality, and then we begin to optimize power. So we do have power data available. So if you have a special use case, you can let us know. Support already could help you. But the thing is, now in the next step, we begin to really tweak things, make it automatically, improve on the DVS, the dynamic voltage and frequency switching, and then we will publish it if it's more like a real world or a really useful. At the moment, the data we would have is preliminary, but let us know. We maybe can even do a benchmark particular to you. Do you need the NPU? Do you load the GPU? And of course, we did quite some tests there for just the hardware validation. We just didn't publish that yet.
Okay. Thank you. There's a specific question on slide 11, Daniel. The audience mentions that there are four processing units, ARM Cortex neural processing MPU, and then ISP through the GPU. Are they programmed using uniform flow, or are they using different tools? In the second case, if they're using different tools, what programming language are used to program the whole the stack, the C or C++ for ARM or CUDA for MPU and GPU? What about ISP?
Okay, so quite a question. And so it depends a little bit. So on the, let's say, just if you just focus on the neural network, you can deploy it on different things, right? If you say, hey, I don't want to use the MPU and I just want to run it on CPUs, so I can, you know, maybe port it to another device too. That's possible. And, you know, also on the EIQ support, you know, supports that. And there is like ARMNN, which is also optimized for the CPU, same GPU, you can use two, you know, or not use it up to use, or the NPU for the devices you have. Outside of the neural network processing, you have, you know, all the development tools I showed you, and they're mostly targeting the CPU and the GPU. I mean, you can do it manually for the NPU and things like that. It's an OpenVX API. It's, I would say, not the most typical way to use it. It's really more common, you know, to use a framework on top of it. But you could even, you know, target, you know, OpenVX or, you know, OpenCL for the GPUs, and then of course just general CPU like you would program any other CPU. I don't know, Marcus, you wanna add on that for maybe from, you know, from the Ozone point of view?
No, I mean, you like, I agree with what you said, and you have the flexibility, and there are developers or customers that are already deploying multiple models in their ADEM Plus platform to run on CPU, GPU, NPU. And, you know, these could be run in parallel or as a sequence or whatever, right? So it's pretty flexible.
Okay. So the next question, how much is the OTA service?
So we are in early access. So price is still in flux. As I said, there is a free tier, and if you need anything about pricing, I recommend to get in touch with our sales, and they can really give you more information there. You can also see there is a little bit, even on the pay, there's different tiers, so they can select, you know, the best one for your use case and then use them.
Okay. So we're about at the time. The one last question: what is the advantage of using the Upverter designer from Toradex website instead of the Upverter.com?
You can also use the general one. This one is just selected for us. It's already like pre-selected, so we already filtered out things which wouldn't work. So if you go on our website, you know, everything you choose there, it works with our system. And what I didn't explain with Upworker, we really focus on the hardware, but it actually also generates your software. So it generates your device tree you can import. So the Linux system on our Torizon, it's integrated with Torizon, actually knows what kind of hardware it is, how it's connected. So it will work out of the box. This is also available for the, you know, on the regular page. But you may have some components there which are maybe not working with the Toradex ecosystem. So that's the difference. But if you're already familiar with the other one, you can go there, or you can start with the Toradex one and use there. It's the same tool. It's really just a filter.
Okay. And one last question. I assume they're referring to Toradex website. In your website, I saw their webinars to help developers. Have you also had some training courses on your site, you know, pending the COVID-19 situation, but, you know, wanting to learn more about that?
Yeah, it's really, some of the webinars are really training. So, I mean, this one is not going into deep or, you know, really show you how to actually execute something, right? But we do have webinars on that, so I can recommend that. And I can really recommend our developer website. So it's 800 articles we update daily. There's a lot of getting started, a lot of step-by-step, a lot of things. So you have a lot, a lot of training there. And then what we also do with customers, if you have a particular, you know, question or anything like that, we can, you know, get our guys together and do a training for you. And then we also have trainings partners, companies like ICS and you know, others. They provide training on, you know, on a range of topics on our hardware. So if you go to them, they can also get you training, maybe you want to learn about Agile or things like that. So they will also help you, and they're familiar with our hardware, so they can customize it for you. They are many times even, you know, run Torizon or the hardware and do the training based on that.
Great. Thanks so much. That's all the questions I could address within the time. Thank you so much for attending our webinar. This will be recorded and be hosted on nxp.com and from Toradex. So thank you for all the presenters, all the great material, and hope you see you in the next one. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.